Today we are sharing with you how at eVoyager SNCF we use HAProxy as a security gate between the cloud and on-premise data centers. Let me introduce myself. My name is Antonin Mellier and I am a cloud architect at eVoyager SNCF. I have been working in production and architecting teams for more than 10 years. And after being involved on on-premise projects for years, I now mostly work in cloud projects.
My name is Samuel Duvibourg and I'm an infrastructure engineer. I have been working at eVoyager SNCF for 3 years and I started by working on the CDN. In the last year, I've been working on our AWS landing zone.
As you can see on the slide, eVoyager SNCF is the SNCF Group's digital partner. SNCF is the French national railway company. eVoyager SNCF operates on its own or for SNCF major website and application like WeSNCF, SNCF Assistant or Rail Europe. Our application sold monthly more than 10 million tickets and they have been downloading 37 million times and we are about 1,500 people. After this brief introduction, I will start by explaining how we came to use HAProxy as a security gateway to the cloud. At eVoyager SNCF, we have a long history of data center hosting. We have been operating our data centers for almost 20 years. Our main applications are installed in 2 data centers in France and run in active-active mode. We develop and operate more than 200 applications that are deployed on about 6,000 servers or virtual machines. For years, we were operating this way with our on-premise hosting. In 2018, we began our journey to the cloud. We first formed a small team of few people whose mission was to provide the tooling and automation to enable our teams to deploy a new application to the cloud. At that time, cloud hosting was only for new projects. About 30 projects were launched on this platform. In 2020, last year, we decided to accelerate our adoption of the cloud by launching our cloud acceleration program. It was an ambitious program and its goal was to migrate all of our applications to the cloud in 18 months and to close our 2 data centers by the end of 2021. To be able to do this migration in time, we decided to rebuild our application identically on the cloud without doing any major refactoring. The benefit of rebuilding our application as is was to be able to migrate quickly and then refactor application once in the cloud. But where will HAProxy be involved in this migration? In this migration, HAProxy will be used for communication with SNCF, our parent company. As a subsidiary and partner of SNCF, we have a lot of interaction with our IT system. Our data centers are directly connected thanks to private links, and our application interact with each other in both directions. We call and consume services from them, and they also call us and consume our services. Until now, to secure our communication between our information systems, we were doing very classical things, with machine-to-machine communication and filtering based on firewall rules. When we have to add new machine or new applications, we had to go through a long process that consisting of opening the flow on the firewalls of each of our infrastructures. Even if we didn't want to refactor our applications, we wanted to improve this process so that it will better respond to the scaling capabilities of the cloud. That's the reason why, when designing our cloud infrastructure, we thought about a new way to communicate between our information systems. We wanted a solution that will be more cloud native while still having the same level of traceability, but which will be more scalable and fully automated. At eVoyager SNCF, we have a long history with HAProxy, and we immediately thought that HAProxy could be the component that will take care of the management and security of these flows. As I said earlier, with our migration, we went from a world where we had data centers with static IPs to a cloud infrastructure in which we could do on-demand provisioning. By using virtual machines, containers, or even serverless applications, we knew that our ecosystem will continuously evolve. It was clear during our reflection that all these dynamic scaling possibilities were not compatible with our way of managing the flow. That's how we concluded that we needed a gateway between these two environments that will be in charge of making the transition between these two worlds. Before choosing HAProxy, we made a quick comparison between a solution managed by our cloud provider and HAProxy. We quickly came to the conclusion that HAProxy offered us many advantages. The first one in terms of cost. We would have to create an NLB for each destination with the SNCF, whereas with HAProxy, a pair of servers is enough to handle all of our traffic. In addition, HAProxy opens up much greater customization possibilities. We also add in-depth monitoring, and our team already had a good knowledge of the product. Now, let me tell you how we have built the SaaS thanks to HAProxy and how we have integrated it into our infrastructure. First of all, we have some constraints when designing the solution. Since the migration had to be done in rebuild and without any code evolution for the applications, the addition of this intermediate component had to be done without any changes for our customers. On-premise, as the flow was open from machine to machine, an application only had access to a limited number of SNCF applications. By setting up a proxy between our information systems, we didn't want our application to have access to more resources than they had on-premise. In the cloud, we use security groups to limit communication between our components, so we wanted to use the same security groups to manage access to our partners' information systems. Finally, we didn't want to degrade the level of confidentiality of our flows. HAProxy should not make any protocol break by decrypting TLS communication, for example. Moreover, we didn't want to manage certificates of our clients by installing it on our servers. We wanted to manage the flows, but not the components, which were in area of responsibility of our client. For TLS exchanges, we have configured a shared TLS frontend for all our exchanges that listen on port 443, and it redirects to the right target according to the SNI field. For HTTP exchanges, the principle is the same as for TLS, except that it is based on the host header. We have an entry point on port 80, which redirects to several destinations. And finally, for exchanges that are not compatible with the two previous configurations, we set up dedicated ports that only forward calls to a destination without analyzing the content of the flow. In terms of deployment, the architecture is rather standard. Our HAProxy servers are declared in one autoscaling group behind the single network load balancer. The autoscaling groups allows us to automatically recreate new instances in case of problem on our servers. We have set up scaling rules according to CPU, RAM, or network consumption, but these indicators are not triggered because of the low resource consumption of our processes. Our machines are automatically deployed in several AZ to avoid problems when malfunctions are localized only on one AZ. This architecture is duplicated to manage incoming flow in the same way. We have now covered the infrastructure part of this project, and Samuel will now explain how we have implemented it.
Thank you, Otona. We will now see the in-depth infrastructure of the SaaS. So to communicate with the SNCF from our on-premise data center, the connections are made from an IP to another. This mode of operation is not suitable for the cloud since the instances change IP frequently. To overcome this problem, we set up a dynamic process of opening flows through HAProxy, Data Plane API, and various AWS services. So this is what we came up with. SAS data flows are represented by JSON configuration files that are versioned in a GitLab repository. Application teams can modify or create these flows by creating a merge request from a custom branch. The GitLab pipeline is then activated to launch some checks on the file format, as well as on some other information entered in the file. So once the pipeline has been successfully completed, the merge request is then validated by a dedicated team. It then triggers the creation pipeline that sends the configuration to an AWS Lambda through an API gateway. This Lambda stores the flow configuration in a database. Then it creates a new HAProxy configuration, which is sent to it through the Dataplane API, which triggers a reload. The configuration is also sent to an S3 bucket, which is used by the EC2s containing the HAProxy. So when an EC2 boots, it downloads the latest version on the S3 without needing to trigger the Lambda. This is useful in case of instance refreshing or outage. Once the configuration is set up, it is sent to a Lambda through an API gateway for processing. This Lambda allows the modification of the AWS services surrounding the HAProxy, as well as the HAProxy itself. In order to handle all the action that the Lambda needs to take in a readable and simple manner, the various AWS services, as well as the configuration flow and data plan API, have been abstracted into Python classes. This level of abstraction allows to manage in any request supporting Dataplane API transaction a complete rollback of action. The available actions range from modifying and creating a configuration to refreshing all flow configuration on HAProxy. It is also possible to put in maintenance mode or modify the weight of a server. In order to communicate easily with this API gateway, a CLI has been made. It allows to quickly execute actions like changing the weight or putting a server into maintenance mode. The last action before the configuration actually arrives on HAProxy is the transformation of the JSON configuration into a configuration file readable by HAProxy. To perform this action, the DJ2 template engine has been chosen. This template is stored in another GitLab repository in order to version it in case of a problem and to be able to rollback easily. If we take the example of earlier, we can see what the associated frontend and backend would be. We notice that the ACL allowing the differentiate this flow from the others, as well as the default backend, which recovers the request not corresponding to the previous ACL. In the frontend, you can see the instruction to capture the SNI header in order to use it in the ACL with the rec SSL SNI keyword. As mentioned earlier, the connection between the SNCF and our on-premise data centers are made from an IP addresses to another. So the security is done through a simple firewall. But in the cloud, IP addresses change frequently. So we had to find a way to guarantee a sufficient level of security without losing the scalability and flexibility of the cloud. To do this, a dynamic allow list system based on security group has been set up. First of all, we had to set up a system to monitor the security group necessary for the creation of allow list. To do this, each account of the organization was assigned an event rule that catches the creation and deletion events of EC2. The event is then transferred to a Lambda through an event bus. The Lambda then checks that the security groups of the EC2 is present in the DynamoDB database. If it is absent, no other action is taken. But on the other hand, if it is present, the Lambda retrieves the IP addresses associated with the security group and stores them in database. In order to add security group to monitor, a gateway API is connected to the Lambda. Thanks to the system previously explained, the SAS Lambda can now connect to the DynamoDB database to listen to its event and retrieve IP addresses. The Lambda then creates an allow list from these IP addresses, for the concerned configuration. These allow lists are map files composed of IP addresses and are specific to each flow. This makes it possible to keep the allow list up to date in near real time. In addition to the database event, a scheduled event runs every 2 minutes to update the allow list whose security groups are assigned to a service other than EC2. Thanks to the Dataplane API abstraction in Python class, it is also possible to easily manage the maps file. In one day, the Lambda is executed on average 350 times to update the HRproxy configuration. Thanks to a lot of optimization, such as asynchronous call, we achieved an execution time of 40 seconds for the update of the 60 flows configuration with 8,000 map entries. Moreover, it triggers a reload only when creating or deleting configuration flow. As seen before, ACLs are defined to differentiate each of the backends, but in addition to that, a map instruction allows filtering by IP. In this instruction, we compare the SRC element, which corresponds to the source IP address, to the map file, which is the key value list, the key being IP addresses and the value, the associated backend. If the source IP address matches an IP address in the map files, the backend is returned. Otherwise, the request is returned to the no match backend, which returns an error. Using the example from earlier, we can see the map comparison instruction in the use backend line and the no match TLS backend. There is one backend like this one for each type of protocol, one for the HTTP, one for the TLS, and one for the TCP. This backend returns an error to the client. In order to delegate as much work as possible and to ensure that the automation is working properly, we have set up monitoring tools. These allow the application teams to be as autonomous as possible. At first, the GitLab pipeline allows us to make first checks on the format as well as on some information such as the ports of the FQDN. This property must be unique according to the protocol used. We then install a black box exporter on the SAS machines, which allowed us to dynamically test the configuration flow. A simple curl to this exporter allows to get information on an IP and port passed in parameter. We can see the metric POP success, which return 1 when the flow is open. Finally, the HRproxy statistic page gives at a glance the health of the flow. We use FluentBit to export the HRproxy logs to an Elasticsearch, and then Kibana display the desired data. To quickly check the allow list status, a filter on the backend no match can be added. A subscription filter goes over the logs of the various lambdas in order to report each execution error. These are then sent to a team channel dedicated to alerts. Finally, we come to the difficulties encountered during the development and to the future evolution we have already thought of. To start with the difficulties, we have several self-hosted Kubernetes in our cloud. They are separated in 2 groups, staging and production. The staging ones are shut down every night and restarted the next morning, generating more than 1,600 IPs. This had the effect of making the Lambda fall into timeout while trying to add all the entries in the map files. To remedy this, we implemented asynchronous execution of tasks such as creating or deleting map file entries via Dataplane API. This allowed the Lambda to run much faster. The other major problem we encountered was the lack of SNI header on legacy applications, making it impossible to route over TLS protocol. Moreover, HRproxy does not yet support UDP protocol. To solve this problem, we had no choice but to create a dedicated AWS network load balancer for each configuration that was in this case. The more we continue to build the SaaS, the more we see room for improvement. For example, we can automate the EC2 HRproxy image building and automated testing on our test environment to prevent any bugs or regression. In order to prevent situations like the one explained earlier in the difficulties, we can implement a user password authentication system that could replace the allow list on some configuration whose security groups generate many IPs. Alerting and automatic diagnosis could also be improved in order to have a self-healing system and minimize human intervention even more. Finally, I will let Antonin summarize the subject of this presentation.
Thank you, Samuel. We have set up a proxy between our world and the SNCF one. It allows us to handle traffic between the cloud and on-premise infrastructure. Our proxy handles TCP, HTTP, and HTTPS connection and route traffic based on port, host header, and SNI field. Access control is based on the mechanism that transforms security groups in IP lists, which are continuously updated onto HA proxy thanks to the Dataplane API. Our solution is scalable, resilient, and fully automated with GitLab, AWS Lambda, and HA proxy Dataplane API. We are now ready to answer your questions if you have any.
For a short Q&A session. Gentlemen, thank you so much for the talk and thank you for joining us here today.
Thank you.
Hi. It was a pleasure.
Excellent. So we've received some questions. As a reminder to everyone, you can submit questions in the general chat. Also post them online on Twitter with the hashtag HAProxyConf. Okay, so for the first question, in your presentation, you described why you use HAProxy instead of a cloud load balancer like AWS NLB. Can you describe again some of the reasons to prefer HAProxy instead of AWS NLB?
Okay, so I will say a few words on it. First of all, when you use a managed load balancer, you have to deal with the limited functionalities. You have to deal with what your cloud provider has implemented, and it's hard to add something if you need. And HAProxy offers us much more features, and it's always possible for us to extend it by using SPOE or LUS script, for example. And Samir, I don't know if you have something to add about it.
No, you told everything. Maybe like Dataplane API made it easier for us to configure dynamically. But you told everything. Yes.
Excellent. Great. Next question. What would you say to encourage others to get involved in open source technologies?
I think that everyone can give some time to help the community. Even if everyone can't maybe participate coding on the project, it's always possible to help the community just by contributing to the mailing list or to the communication channel, or even like what we did, just by sharing our experience on public conferences. Everybody can't code in HAProxy, but just sharing the experience is a good way to help the community, I think.
Sure. And Antonin, on that subject, you were a speaker at HAProxyConf 2019, which was held in Amsterdam. With all the world events, feels like a lifetime ago. How would you compare the experience to this year in an all virtual event and having virtual conferences instead of in-person ones? And do you have any sort of different perspective? Has your perspective on HAProxy changed at all since you were last on stage presenting back in Amsterdam?
Oh, it's the preparation is different because in Amsterdam we have to speak just behind a big room with many, many people. Today we have recorded it before with Samuel, so the preparation is different, but it's always a pleasure to share what we what we did and what we did with HAProxy.
Yep, and I know the community appreciates it very much. So again, thank you for being really consistent in coming to share your perspective. So we have a few more questions. Oh, the community is always trying to gather feedback. So you mentioned UDP. What type of UDP protocol do you need?
Oh, for UDP, we have a system that deal with IBM licensing. So some of our servers need to communicate with an IBM licensed server hosted on SNCF infrastructure. And to communicate together, both systems need to send messages via UDP. There is a failover mechanism over TCP, but I think that UDP is more fast in that case.
Excellent. Okay, the next question is related to your cloud deployment. So are you cloud provider neutral, or did you 100% go with AWS?
We go 100% to AWS, yes. We are not cloud agnostic.
Excellent. Okay, and I think we have time for one more question. So the term cloud native is heard a lot. What's the main benefit of this approach? And what does the term cloud native mean to you?
What does it mean? First, I think it means that we build our application and our system by thinking cloud, like with all the tools and the things we can use in AWS for our case. But it makes it really easier to build applications, and so cloud native is a way of doing our application just by using AWS component, and thanks to that we are much more faster, I think, and more reliable sometimes, because we don't have to build everything again.
Yep, certainly. Well, again, thank you so much both for presenting on this topic. Are there any final thoughts that you have for the audience?
Thanks to listening to us. I hope you liked it. And if you want, you can connect to us on LinkedIn. And that's it. Thank you.
Yes, thanks.
Excellent. Well, Antonin and Samuel, thank you so much for participating in this year's HAProxyConf 21, and enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you.